my Lord and my Savior, to the Holy Spirit, who is our seal and guarantee of the redemption of our mortal bodies. To my wife, Rosalind, continue brewing my gumbo. To all of the ministers and their spouse. To our esteemed deacons and their spouse. To our awesome. Sometimes I'm trying to think of a new word to say. I gotta move beyond awesome. Give me a rotating thesaurus next week and come up with me some fresh adjectives and adverbs. But for today, I'm going to just say awesome musicians. Musicians and the minister of music and team, they just read my spirit. It's just something about the song selection. And even when they add in a new song, it's like, you know they talking to the Lord, and that the Holy Spirit can lead them there because it ministers to our soul, the inner core of your soul. Everywhere you go, you don't have musicians like these. Praise God for them. Our media ministry, our reader ministry, ushers on the floor, to all the visitors in the house, and to you, the royal family of God, known locally as the McKinney First Baptist Church. I bid you in the name of our Lord and Savior, if you would be so kind, turn with me to Mark chapter 8. We will read verses 22 through 26. The Gospel according to Mark, the second book of the New Testament. Mark's Gospel in the New King James Translation. You will find these words. If we are physically able to stand, I ask that you do so. In the New King James Translation, verse 22 says, then he came to Bethsaida, and they brought a blind man to him, and begged him to touch him. So he took the blind man by the hand, led him out of the town. Oh Lord. And when he had spit on his eyes, say, oh Lord, again. And put his hands on him, he asked him if he saw anything. And he looked up and said, I see men like trees walking. I'm not making this up. This is the text right here. Then he put his hands on his eyes and again made him look up. And he was restored and saw everyone clearly. Then he sent him away to his house saying, neither go into the town, nor tell anyone in the town. We will use for a subject for this morning, touch me again, Jesus. May you see. Touch me again, Jesus. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we come this morning. Lord, this is another awesome day because it's a day you made and we're rejoicing and glad in it. Father, if the Holy Spirit doesn't speak through me right now, then I'm giving a speech. Lord, I never want to stand before your people with a speech. I want to share with them what you gave me as I prayed, as I fasted, as I called upon your name to say, Lord, what is it you want me to tell you? Now, Lord, I decrease that you may increase. Anoint me in your presence, then saturate me in your spirit, that with accuracy, clarity, depth, and truth, I may proclaim your holy, inspired word. It is in Jesus Christ's name that I will always pray and give thanks and ask that you forgive me. of anything we may have said, thought, or done contrary to your word. Amen. Ushers, you may be seated. Listen to me carefully. There are times, certain times, special times, when the Lord calls us out of our daily routine lives. These are special seasons, where His only command to us is seek His face. So as we fast and pray, as we worship, as we read and meditate on His word, and confess and repent of sin, you know, that really is what seeking God's face really means. God will then share something precious and vitally important that He wants to do in us to take us to another level of service to Him. God will share a new assignment with us. God will give us vision and direction. God can then deliver us from besetting sins and weights as described in Hebrews chapter 12, that may have plagued us for years. When we sincerely seek God's face, He is ready to grant us greater effectiveness in ministry. When we sincerely seek His face, we can experience breakthroughs. Our sermon text is going to reveal a very unique miracle that occurs only in the gospel according to Mark. Our sermon text is going to demonstrate to us that we can be restored, we can be delivered, and receive renewed power after we have been touched by Jesus. So with the text and the Holy Spirit as my guide, I'd like to briefly share with you three object lessons regarding the subject, touch me again, Jesus. Object lesson number one, it is the responsibility of believers to bring others to Christ. Let's walk through the text again. In verse 22, it says, then He came to Bethsaida, and they brought Him a blind man to Him and begged Him to touch Him. One of the most significant facts Christians must get in our heart and in our mind so that it will move us into action is this. God did not save us from our sins so that we can sit down, look pretty in the church house as we await our time to go to heaven. God saved us from our sins, and He expects us, let me rephrase that, He commands us to bring others to Him to be saved from their sins. Now note in verse 22, the text says they begged Jesus to touch their friend. They were desperate for Jesus to heal and deliver. You see, I believe this type of desperation for Jesus to touch and heal our family, our friends, and our neighbors is sorely missing in the church at large. We become spiritually lethargic. It takes the effectual, fervent prayers of the righteous to avail much, and for these prayers to enter into heaven. Throughout the Gospels, we repeatedly see where people brought those who could not come on their own, but they would bring them to Jesus. In Mark chapter 7, there was a man who was deaf and dumb, and he was brought to Jesus to be healed. In Mark chapter 2, we find a man who was sick and with palsy, but his friends brought be made whole. We are living in what could be the very last of the last days. World leaders, including the United States of America, have talked about preemptive nuclear attacks. Countries are sanctioning sexual immorality. Murder, suicide, and drug uses is at epic proportions. The apostasy, a turning away from biblically established truths, is already occurring. These are the very signs that the Bible tells us will usher in the rapture, and it will be the dominant lifestyle of those who are left behind in the tribulation. So the real question is this: how desperate are you to get into the presence of Jesus if you're saved? And then how desperate are you to bring others who do not know Jesus into his presence? The devil loves to keep the church haggling over minor issues for extended time frames because he knows that will keep that church from being focused on kingdom and nation. Verse 22 reflects ministry in action. You see, sharing the gospel with the unsaved and then equipping the saved represent what should be the two highest priorities of the church. We must pray earnestly and consistently for the unsaved of this church and community to come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And as long as there's breath in my body, I will not be silent about the fact that Jesus is the one and the only way unto salvation. Nor will I sugarcoat the gospel to appease its ease. Christians must be compelled by the love of Christ to earnestly and fervently go share the gospel and bring others in their sphere of influence to Jesus the Christ. And if we fail to minister in this way, we neglect our true calling by God, because the Great Commission is not a suggestion. And it was given to all believers. Church, the only way some people will ever get to Jesus is by us bringing the gospel to them through our verbal and lifestyle witness. Object lesson number two. I jot this one down in the Bible. Whatever Jesus wants to do to me for me to receive my breakthrough, I'll take it. Now that may just be personal. That might not be you. So let's look at it in this text and see how it occurs with this man. Look at verse 23, and I'm going to read through verse, I'm going to read just the A clause of verse 23 right now. So he took the blind man by the hand, led him out of the town. He took him by the hand, he's blind, and he led him out of town. Now I know if you are a Bible student, you can't help but wonder, why did Jesus have to take the man out of town to heal him? I mean, Jesus could have healed him right there. Well, first notice the definitive article the in front of the word town, so it's referring to a specific town. So when we study, we got to go look for chapter 10 and verse 13, it affirms Jesus proclaimed a curse on Bethsaida because of his unbelief when he said, "Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes." So Jesus decided to take the man away from an unbelieving environment. See, that's a fault. You might be hanging out with that every time you start telling them what God is showing you and what you believe God to be doing, they like to temper what God is saying to you like they can overrule God. And you're going to find yourself when God gives you something and he places something in your spirit that you're going to need to get around. Blind man out of town because of the unbelief that was in that town. Jesus is still seeking to take us by the hand from unbelieving, sinful environments to save us, to deliver us, and to disciple us. There are some blessings and breakthroughs. Listen to me carefully. Jesus is not going to give you until you make the step of disassociating yourself from, listen, sinful environments. By lifestyle people. And you gotta say that properly. You can't say sinful people because you'd be all by nobody could be able to hang out with nobody. Because I read all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So I didn't say people who have sinned. I said people who sin by lifestyle. The folk who sin by lifestyle, these are the iniquity sinners. No right, but do wrong. There are some blessings and breakthroughs Jesus is not going to give you until you stop shacking them. There's some blessings and breakthroughs Jesus is not going to give you until you stop having affairs. Until you start witnessing and serving. Until you forgive others and extend forgiveness. Start witnessing to the unsaved and you start gracing. So call on the name of the Lord and ask him to take away anything and anyone from you that leading you to sin. Also, by leading the man away from town, it was symbolic of Jesus' desire to disciple the man. On Tuesday, I'm going to a revived teacher's meeting. Matter of fact, it's an emergency call to me. It's an emergency. Revived Texas, real briefly, is churches in North Texas who are coming together so that we can go out into the community and basically say, "Can we pray for you and share Christ with you?" Because the objective of our prayers is to find out if they know Jesus. If they don't know Jesus, then to share Christ with them. And since April the 12th, when this movement started, 800 people have come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. I'm talking about 8 people who got mad at the pastor at Church X and then went to Church Y. That's not adding to the church there. That just swips, flip-flopping membership. I'm talking about somebody who wasn't going to nobody's church, who didn't know Jesus, nor acknowledged that accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. But the sad part is that the reason it's an emergency meeting is that 800 people have given their lives to Christ. There are over 200 people who have given their lives to Christ, but no church has embraced them and accepted them that we can disciple them. So that's why time out is being called. It says we got to come together, church, because the objective of what we're doing is not only that they say yes to Jesus on Monday, but two Because the devil is going to attack everybody who gave their life to Christ the first time. When you give your life to Christ, the devil is right there to tell you, I don't know what you did that for. You know you still like coming over here. You know me. You're going to go over there. You know you're going to go to this website. You know you're going to go back and do this. The devil is sitting there waiting. And if there's not some word, if that's not somebody that is earnestly and fervently praying that God will give them strength to go through that, many will fail. In our text, the blind man had to trust Jesus and listen to Jesus' instructions and getting away from the crowds in town. This led him to being one-on-one with Jesus so that he could be saved. The Lord desires for some one-on-one time with everybody in here today. In the Word and in prayer. And if healing and deliverance is going to happen, it can only happen through Jesus. We need to quit acting like we can change people. I don't care how crazy they act. I don't care how much they need help. But until they realize they need help, you can't change. What you're going to have to do is put some meat power down. What you're going to have to do is cry out like never before. What we're going to have to do is go to the master. The only change agent there is, spiritually, even physically, is through Jesus the Christ. And if healing and deliverance will happen again, we're not going to get it through nobody but the master. We need to realize that when we give them over to Jesus, we're not surrendering. We're not throwing in the white towel. We're not saying nothing is going to happen. We're trying to realize if something's going to happen, it's going to happen by Jesus. You see, when Jesus takes over, sinners become saints. When Jesus takes over, but you stand on that. are shut together. They almost like they gummy and glued together. So Jesus spitting on the eyelids, his saliva was going to supernaturally lubricate the man's eyelids. But here's the key thing. Get it right down the fact. Jesus knew he was going to heal it, but he was going to do it in stages. It was going to be a gradual healing. And see, that is something we don't really like to hear. We want it always heal and deliver the same way. Because he had healed some other people earlier by touching. Yes. See, what Jesus is trying to say is, quit putting me in a box. Quit trying to limit how I can heal. Quit trying to limit how I'll do a breakthrough. Quit trying to limit me with your finite mind. That's why you can't get stuck in your way, because your way is finite. Jesus' way is infinite. Some people will never receive their breakthrough that they're seeking because they're not desperate enough. They haven't gotten tired of being tired of the situation. Sometimes we are so used to being down that we think being down is where we're supposed to be. That's why you gotta read this book and you will realize God has a mission and a plan and a purpose for your life. You are fearfully and wonderfully made in his image. Quit letting other people dictate to you your worth or your significance.
Amen.
Then the Lord spit in his face. Now I'm just gonna say it like this. Now this I'm gonna take you somewhere that's the Diddy folk. I'm gonna take you somewhere where folk that just come to church and just come to church won't go. But I'm gonna tell you this, there are a few of us in here radical enough for all that Jesus has in store for us that are willing to say to the Lord, Lord, spit in my face. Lord, touch me. When you are ready and willing to say to Jesus, Lord, whatever it takes for you to give me what you want me to receive, I'll take it. Let me tell you, your breakthrough is right around. If you have to take me through a storm, then take me through a storm. If I'm at a point in my walk with the Lord, I will say to Jesus, Lord, I'm willing to receive whatever you want to give me. Lord, I'm willing to lack whatever you want to withhold. Lord, I'm willing to relinquish whatever you want to take. Lord, I'm willing to suffer whatever you inflict. And Lord, I'm willing to be what you require. You are sure enough ready to be saved, healed, delivered, made free, and released. All right, Bella, go and get my car broken. Touch a few toes today. Let me read these verses, final verses. The latter part of verse 23 says, he asked him, and when he had spit on his eyes, put his hands on him, he asked him if he saw anything. He looked up and said, I see men like trees walking. Then he put his hands on his eyes again and made him look up. And he was restored and saw everything clearly. Then he sent him away to the house, saying, neither go into the town, nor tell anyone in the town. Now verse 23, last clause, the C clause of verse 23 reflects Jesus' second touch to this
place. Some people will never receive their breakthrough that they're seeking because they're not desperate enough. They haven't gotten tired of being tired of the situation.
we think being down is where we're supposed to be. That's why you gotta read this book and you will realize God has a mission and a plan and a purpose for your life. You are fearfully and wonderfully made in His image. Quit letting other people dictate to you your worth or your significance.
Amen.
Then the Lord spit in His face. Now, I'm going to say it like this. Now, I'm going to take it somewhere that some many folk won't go. I'm going to take it somewhere where folk that just come to church and just come to church won't go. But I'm going to tell you this. There are a few of us in here radical enough for all that Jesus has in store for us that are willing to say to the Lord, Lord, spit in my face. Lord, touch me. When you are ready and willing to say to Jesus, let me tell you, your breakthrough is right around the corner when you get there. So Jesus, if you have to take me through a storm, then take me through a storm. If I'm at a point in my walk with the Lord, I will say to Jesus, Lord, I'm willing to receive whatever you want to give. Lord, I'm willing to lack whatever you want to withhold. Lord, I'm willing to relinquish whatever you want to take. Lord, I'm willing to suffer whatever you inflict. And Lord, I'm willing to be what you require. When you get to this point, you are sure enough ready to be saved, healed, delivered, made free, and blessed.
Yes.
All right. Melvin, I'm going to get my car working. Over all of Israel. You know why? God promised David what he was going to do. He knew he
quite often with us. Now look at verse 24. Verse 24, I'm going to read it one more time. It says, and he looked up and said, I see men like trees walking. I don't know about you, but I never saw a man like look like a tree walking. After Jesus touched the blind man a second time, he asked him that question and he said, I see men like trees walking. Now, if Jesus had chosen to, the man could have been touched once, healed totally and immediately. Jesus didn't even have to touch the blind man. He could have healed him by just speaking a word. Jesus chose to heal in stages and by a process because oftentimes that's his preferred method. You see, a process will draw us closer to Jesus. A process will give you a testimony to share with others who get in the same situation as you. A process will help you reflect greater gratitude and help you have perpetual praise and worship. You see, some of us who shout almost just walking in the door, we have been through so much. God has delivered so much. We don't have to be pumped up to praise and worship. We've been through a process. We've had to endure some pain and some suffering. So we hung around and it takes us away from the doubting, topless people. It had to bring us around some folks who would say things like, we think we may endure. So when the blind man said, I see men like trees walking, really shucking his corn down to the cob again, it could look like something like this. How many of y'all remember? See, y'all youth, y'all don't understand this. Y'all gonna turn on the TV and come on perfect. It look perfect. It's in high definition. You can turn it on. Matter of fact, I never forget, I worked for DirecTV, y'all. And when the first high definition television first came out, I'll never forget this. We were in Las Vegas. And we were having the CE, Consumer Electronics Show, CES show. And I was right by the big screen. And they brought in a huge screen that they hadn't even, they only had one of them made. It was an 80-inch high def TV at that time. And they had it on the Discovery Channel. So you know I was somewhere around the Discovery Channel. But while I wasn't looking, there was a scene of a snake striking a bird or something. And all I know, as soon as I turned, all I could see was the snake bite. And it was, the light was so clear, I just went back. That's some good TV.
Then he put his hands on his eyes again, made him look up, and he was
was restored to me, saw everything clear. Isn't it good to know that when Jesus starts up, he gonna finish it? Philippians 1 to 6 says it like this: he who has begun a good work in you is gonna complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. You see, our spiritual rebirth goes through stages too. There's justification, sanctification, glorification. It's a process. Now, hear me clearly. It's not a process to get saved. You don't have to go through 1,001 kind of things to be saved. Justification is a one-time thing when it's done from the heart for real. When you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, you saved now and through eternity you saved. There's nothing processual about that. What a process come in is after you saved. It's called sanctification. And sanctification means that you are being saved from the power of sin. Right. Justification, you were saved from the penalty of sin.
Right.
And then glorification, which says I'm in the cooking the gumbo, I just throw this one in for free. Glorification is a futuristic thing that we get after we're raptured and we're with the Lord in heaven. That's when we get our glorified body.
Right.
Where we can come and go as the Lord desires. You can go in and out of buildings. You can go in and out of walls. You can show up where you want to show up. And that's what Jesus did. See, he gave you a body like that now. Man, if I look trouble, you might be in. You can sneak and dive and go anywhere you want to. Oh, Lord, that's another sermon. I don't even think about that too long. So, this statement also says something else. When he says men that look like trees walking, it also suggests to us that this man was not born blind. He became blind over time. Or how else would he know what a man looked like or a tree looked like if he was always blind?
Amen.
Jesus wanted this man to go, and notice in the last verse, after he healed him and he saw clearly, 26 says, then he sent him home to his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell anyone in the town. At first, that one kind of caught me. That caught me just like being Jesus spitting in the face. I'm like, wait a minute, Jesus, if you healed and delivered me, I know I got to go tell somebody.